Meeting to order. Yeah, we'll move with move the minutes of the previous meeting.
So moved, Mr. Mayor.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks, Councilor Practicon. Delegations.
First delegation we have registered, Your Worship, is Councilor Wyatt, and he's here to speak on the Memorandum of Understanding with the YMCA 3-Model Expansion Partnership.
Good morning. Welcome.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
I've handed out packages to all of you that I thought would be helpful. A few of you were here when we dealt with this matter in the last term, but some of you weren't. So I just wanted to give you some background. And I want to thank you, Mr. Mayor, for the support of the motion that's before you here today. This is a tremendous opportunity. We as a city, we haven't really invested in indoor recreation in terms of rec facilities for some time now. We have other cities, other communities across Canada, across Manitoba, have over the last decade or so made major investments in indoor recreation. And, you know, the challenge always is not only building the facilities, but then operating them. Right now, inside the city of Winnipeg, with our growing city, there is a growing demand for indoor recreation in three areas of the city, the Southwest, in the growing neighborhoods of the Southwest, in the East, and in the Northwest. Working with the YMYWCA as a strategic partner is something which is advantageous to the city. They have experience, they have knowledge, they have entered into agreements with other municipalities across Canada to offer services in terms of running facilities and also giving us access to those facilities for a la carte programming that our community services department may require or want to use. Behind me, I've given you some samples of what can be done and what has been done recently. That over there, actually, Councillor Mays will like that. That's the city of Brandon. That's their indoor, fairly new in the last 2 years, YMCA in downtown Brandon.
I forgot me the way they could make some programs. That's what you're saying?
No, I'm not alluding to anything. And London Stony Creek, this is London, Ontario, not London, England. And this is a facility, just to give you a bit of an idea, the facilities in question have been developed over the last number of years. Stony Creek is 75,000 square feet. The City of London covered, it was a $31 million project. The City of London covered $22 million of that project, to give you an idea. The City of Brandon investment, I don't have the total budget for that project, but the City of Brandon's investment was $4 million in that project. Here behind me, you have, this is inside Stony Creek. This is, this is kind of a common, you can see over, what's interesting about this photo is you can see the attachment of the library. So libraries are attached to many of these facilities. And then on my, right behind me here, this is a facility that's now under construction in the city of Calgary. Calgary actually has two facilities under construction. The other one was a bit just over the top in terms of what I wanted to show. It was massive, 200,000 square feet. It looked like a spaceship had landed on the planet. That's what they're designing. But this one here is called Quarry Park, which is in the southeast of Calgary. That's under construction now. It's a 90,000 square foot facility, so a little closer to what we were looking at 70 or 75,000 square feet. It has a $60 million capital budget. And the WISE required investment is $4 million balanced from government. The benefit, of course, to the municipalities, Rocky Ridge is the other one that I was, didn't bring, was 330,000 square feet being built now in Calgary in the northwest at $106 million. The benefit, of course, is that the WISE bring their expertise and knowledge and just their track record of running facilities. And the whole concept here was to get this program growing. Because there's certain parts of the city right now which are, you know, well served with rec facilities. So, for example, the south, some parts of the southwest or west, you have Rady JCC, you have the rehab center, you have their facilities, you have the Y way out in the west. But then there's other areas which are growing in our city where we haven't really had the chance to really reinvest in recreation in many, many years. And yet the demand is there. And then the challenge with that, of course, is once you build these facilities, then you have to operate them, if we were to do it municipally and run them municipally. The big dividend to us, if we enter in a strategic partnership with an organization like this, is that they bear out the operating costs by and large. They bear out those costs unless we go in and we start offering programming a la carte. And that's a huge thing. I can tell you in the growing communities of Northeast and East Winnipeg is something that I hear all the time. The Y that's out in Councillor Mays' area is packed. I have residents that drive from mine to there, and it's just full. You know, it's there's just a huge demand right now. We need to get these facilities like anything else in our city. I know we have tons of demands on our purse. I know there's lots of pressure in terms of infrastructure for new strategic infrastructure. It would be bridges, rapid transit, bike paths, what have you. But the reality is, this is something which I think we can't avoid. It speaks to the quality of life of our city. And the great thing about it is we have an entity that's credible, that is prepared to enter into this partnership with us at this point. They have been patiently waiting. They have. We did, as a council, direct the public service to come to write an MOU to sign a memorandum of understanding with the YMYWCA. And I can tell you that the process has not been held up at the YMYWCA end. And that's why this motion was initiated. I realize also that it was a tough budget year, and the decision was made to defer just over $1.7 million in seed money, which would have allowed them to start their planning work and design work in the first Y, the Southwest Y. And we deferred that, but my hope is that commitment will still be there and we can still see that happen. Their goal is to build one Y, about 75,000 square feet, and then get that one operating. Then a year or two later, learn the mistakes, the kinks, the things they got to straighten out, and then move into the second Y. They want to move into the east, and then they want to go to the northwest. And they see all this area of the city as huge growth. So it's exciting. This is a vision which is, when they came to the city here, Mr. Mayor spoke to a council back in December of 2013. It garnered a lot of attention. And Kent Patterson, unfortunately, couldn't be here today, but he has submitted a letter that you have before him. He's the president and chief executive officer of the YMYWCAs. Supporting the motion before you and urging that we go forward on this. This was something that garnered a lot of support and attention. Folks really, it resonated with residents just because it's something that, you know, in our long winter climates, this is something which is really in need and in demand in our city. So those are my words. I hope it's pretty straightforward. I don't think the motion needs deferral. It's just basically directing the administration to come back in 180 days with the MOU.
Questions? Councilor Morantz.
Thank you very much for your advocacy and pasture on this issue, Councilor Wyatt. And I guess in my capacity as finance, I always ask myself, along with many of the programs that can we afford them? And as you correctly pointed out, the $1,750,000 was not rebudgeted in 2015 and was in fact used to help us balance our operating budget for 2014. And I have to go back and check, but I think the program contemplated a total city commitment close to $50 million, I think in the neighborhood of $46 or $47 million. And it was contemplated, I think, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, that this would be a one-third kind of sharing arrangement where the Y would contribute their share of the profits with as well. And one of the reasons that this $1,750,000 was rebudgeted, as I was briefed by the administration, was that there had been no movement, not from the Y, but from the province. In terms of commitment, and therefore there was no point in rebudgeting for 15 because we just didn't have the the funds in place to proceed. So I guess I'm wondering, with respect to this particular motion, why, and your presentation as well, why is the issue of provincial contribution absent?
If you read the, I've included in your package, that's a good question, Councillor. I've included in your package a copy of the motion that was part of the 2014 operating budget that went to council and was approved by council, adopted by council. And in the motion, it specifically does call, it states the one-third, one-third, one-third. But if you read through the motion, and I'll take you down to clause N3, that with 1 and 2 above subject to funding agreement include public service satisfactory agreement, the public service report back to council. So we right now, we have heard through the grapevine in terms of the province, but we have never formally heard. I hear what you're saying, that the provincial government has indicated informally that they may not be interested, but I don't want to say that because that's not something that has formally come back from them. And until we have a report that comes back and says, look, at the end of the day, if a report comes back and says an MOU, we here's a draft MOU, but we can't really sign it because the province is not involved, well, you know what, let us know that. But the public service has only reported to us informally, and I think it deserves formal reporting back in light of the fact that this was a formal direction given by council. And to speak to your other issue, I mean, as finance chair, I was expecting part of your question to be, where is the money coming from? And you're right. I mean, this was done a couple of years ago now, when you think about the work that went into this policy. And the numbers, I'm sure, have changed, right? That's one of the downsides of waiting, the construction cost numbers. You know, if you look at the growth that's occurred, we very eagerly, or we don't hesitate to capture the new property taxes coming out of all these new communities with the growth that's happening. And we put that right to the bottom line of the city in terms of our operating budget, in terms of our general revenues. And really, I think what's going to have to happen here is we're going to have to say, look, we know that we're going to have to take a small part of that, not a lot, but dedicate a small part of that for the next number of years towards a program to build these facilities. Because ultimately, we will have to build them. The demand from the public is going to be there. The question is whether we have to build them and operate them and own them, or whether or not we could try to leverage by getting a third party like this involved and keep our costs to a minimum. And so that's what I hope. I'm optimistic the province will come to the table. I'd be surprised if they didn't. Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Councillor Lutz and then Councillor Mays.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for seconding this motion. It's a very important motion that I will be supporting. And thank you, Councillor Wyatt, for all your work and background on this and bringing me up to speed. I thoroughly enjoy working with you on innovative projects. And
thank you.
Projects like this. This project, or this MOU, is very important for the southwest quadrant of Winnipeg, that this go forward. We've been doing a lot of work in the community of the Waverly West area. We've managed to amalgamate our two community centers out there, Richmond Kings and Waverly Heights. We've worked together in partnership with the Pembina Trail School Division and also with Mr. Patterson and the Y. We've all come to sort of an agreement in principle to move forward on this, and I believe, Mr. Mayor, you've received letters of support regarding that. The importance of this community center in South Winnipeg is South Winnipeg is growing again to the size of Brandon. We were talking a lot about Brandon here, but it's growing at a pace faster than anticipated, and the tax base from the community really isn't, it's contributing to the city, but there is no community center, and as they say, there is no heart in the community. And we need to, as a city, move forward on this initiative and look to partnerships, because the model of community engagement with smaller community centers spread out and around is an old model. It is working in some parts of the city, and in some parts we're not seeing the volunteers and the dedication that we once had. And I think to use to be strategic and wise in our investment, we need to look to partnerships. I've been in discussion with the province in an informal manner with various representatives and MLAs in the area, and they have not said no, they've not said yes formally, but they clearly recognize that there needs to be some form of commitment to the residents of Bridgewater and South Point and South Winnipeg as a whole, the Fort Richmond area and St. Norbert area. So I'm very supportive of moving forward on this. We have to keep moving forward on this so we get to the point where we can engage the province further on discussions. And one of the benefits of the Y is they have a unique ability to reach out and also secure additional funding and partnerships from other levels of government, federally and from private. So I think this is something we should support and really pursue. And I've been doing a lot of work in my community on this. We do have a report coming forward from administration in September that is addressing the first Y, which would be the one in Southwest Winnipeg. And they're going to, administration is coming forward speaking to the human resources required, the financial required resources, land consolidation, and partnership opportunities. So administration is moving along on this first one. And like you said, the Y is very interested. The first one, working through that, enabling a better understanding of the second and third. So, again, thank you very much for all your work in bringing me up to speed on this. I'm really supportive, and thank you.
Yeah, well, you were quite knowledgeable out of it about it already, Councillor. So I know I appreciate that. I appreciate your words. I thank you for your comments. I guess the key thing in my And I think it's recognized that the Southwest is the Y, and the Y wants to go there first. The crucial thing, I think, is that we, when we move forward on that, and if it's moving great, that's fantastic. A lot of the stuff you're mentioning to me is new to me. But if we're moving forward, I think it's crucial that we as a council clearly support a policy and say this is done on the basis that we're going to roll out a program of two other facilities, one in the east and one in the northwest, because there is a perception in some quarters of the city that the south and the southwest, and I don't necessarily always share it, not always, that the south receives predominantly a greater share. And you know what? There's a huge population base there, and I get that. But we have to ensure that we have geographic equality in this program, and we address the growth that's occurring. In terms of especially the tax rolls, I mean, we're adding, you know, Northwest Winnipeg, for example, the new communities growing up there are tremendous. And so everybody is contributing to the pie in terms of the growth of taxes to the city and the new residents. I just think we need to ensure that we roll out a program that's realistic, so citywide. So thank you.
Councillor Mason and Oracle.
Yeah, I think if you'd stopped me any time on the street in the last 2 years and just dealt towards why at an MOU, I would have said, oh, it's that why thing. Yeah, because Councillor Y has really been tireless on this. And I think that's good, because sometimes these things that you find just get passed and people forget about them and studies drift away or things don't get concluded. So I thank you for your persistence on this. And Councillor Lukes has certainly picked up the torch from Councillor Swandell in terms of lobbying for this for the Southwest, which is also fair enough. Certainly, when this came out in 2013, there was some criticism from the left that why are we partnering with the Y to build pools and we should be building them ourselves. And it's just worth noting there's certainly a new library and money going in, new library going in beside Bonnie Vitale Pool, which is a city Winnipeg pool. We're putting money into Pan Am Pool for the Canada Games, quite a bit of money, in fact, parking lot and the facility. And Margaret Grant, which was one that people thought would close if we ever did this project with the Y, we reopened with $1 million, and Councillor Lukes was there at the reopening ceremony on behalf of the city. So we are reinvesting in our city pool. So then the Y isn't taking away from anything we're doing. My one question, though, is I did enough negotiating that where the motion resolves to direct that we will conclude this within 180 days, but it doesn't say or, you know, we're pulling the funding or something. I just, can we? And I don't think it's a good idea to tell our staff to conclude within 180 days because they may feel they have to agree to just about anything put forth in order. Their direction is get a deal. So can we change that to make every best effort, every reasonable effort? I just think I get the point. This needs to get concluded. But you don't want to say to the people who you're bargaining for, just get it. You have to get a deal within 180 days or you know, you're going to have to answer to us. So I get the intent is this thing needs a deadline. We don't want to threaten to pull the funding. We need to not tie our own people's hands.
Well, I would, remember saying 180 days or sooner would be a... and to be fair to our staff, I wrote the motion in consultation with the public service. I asked, is 6 months reasonable? And they said, absolutely. So I didn't... This was... The 180 days didn't come from me. I was actually going to give it a little bit more. And they said, no, 6 months it works. There's a draft now that's going back and forth, apparently. But your points... So I think...
I think the target of a date is a good idea. You could always, as we know, motions like this, you can extend it for 30 days or what have you, if it doesn't work out, or 60 days. But your point, Alan, I just want to note on your other matter you mentioned, Councillor, it's an excellent point because the concept as well, we're building a new library, we're replacing the old library in the east end of the city of Transcona, and it's put it beside this. And the experience has been when we did that with Cindy Clausen, what we heard from the community at that time was the rec facility, Cindy Clausen, was open longer hours in the library, and residents were phoning councillors and the public service and said, why isn't the library open the same hours as the rec facility? We're coming out here and the library's closed. And so we actually had to change the library hours at Cindy Clausen. So what did that mean? That actually meant longer hours, which meant more program time, which meant more staffing time, right? More cost to us. But in terms of that issue that's concerned to labor, I can tell you right now the why has been emphatic, absolutely clear. This is not a quid pro quo. They will not support a scenario where we're building new rec facilities to close an old one down over here. You know, they don't want to be part of that, and they don't support that, and they've made that extremely clear. And I think our practice has been the opposite. We're reinvesting in Sherbrooke, but we're reinvesting in King George, but we're reinvesting pools around the city and rec facilities where we can, right? And so, but that's a great point. Thank you.
I think as we grow to 1 million people, The challenge is going to be not enough facilities. I mean, you try getting into swimming lessons, as my family's tried. There's a lot of competition to get in, and there's a demand for increased recreation. I just hope when and if it's built in the Southwest that we can go on a bike on our new active transportation network with you, and maybe we can bike there, and then when there's one up in Transcona, we can all take a cycle on, again, expanded active transportation. But I appreciate your passion for active living. So.
Well, no, I...
Thank you, Mr. Wayne. I, for one, need to get on my bike a little more, believe me.
Well, so do I. Yeah. No, thank you very much. If for any of you who are going to Edmonton for FCM coming up next month, if you have a chance, go to the Terwilliger Center. It's in the southwest of Edmonton. It's a relatively about 3-4 years old. It's an amazing facility where you walk in and they have a gym, indoor track, a pool system. It's owned by the city of Edmonton. This one's owned, not a Y. It's owned by the city. The city actually found that after they opened it, their projections in terms of revenues surpassed what they thought. They were actually making money now on this facility. And I asked, are you taking that money and putting it into a fund for perpetual maintenance? And no, we're taking it and using it to balance our budget. But it's amazing. And you know, they did combine arenas as well, so it's a bigger facility because of indoor ice. But even with that aside, they've done some, it's an amazing rec facility, and I would encourage you to take a tour. I have a contact there if any of you want to go and have a look at it. So, right.
Councillor Olicott, thank you.
I'm not going to shake some honey on this one as much as everybody else seems to. I'm still not that in love with this idea, and I'd like to ask you some questions regarding the modeling that we're moving to in this one. So the why, the difference was, so the why is going to charge people to come in. Is that correct?
Correct. They have a system of payments, a fee system, yeah.
So, and this model would be, I guess we call them a mega center. These would be larger center, campus models, whatever you want to euphemize, but they're very larger centers than our neighborhood community centers. So these are large regional centers, we'll call them.
Yeah, they're offering facilities that the community centers typically, historically, have not offered, such as a gymnasium, pools, aquatics, indoor track, these sorts of things, yeah.
Well, again, we do offer almost every one of those services in the public sector right now. We offer pools, we offer tracks, we offer meeting rooms, very low fee, and based in the local community. Do you see this modeling, the larger modeling, how do you see this being accessible to everybody as our regular? We're taking $50 million from our community center modeling, or from that budget area, from recreational, whatever. $50 million is no longer going to go into revamping our own community centers, our own smaller sites that we used to reinvest into with a public, not public, with a nonprofit partner who gets established their own fee rates.
Sure.
For that, to do that, to build these regional centers, which will also draw in from the capital region, will benefit them as well, because they're all going to be placed in the suburban areas of our city. So again, we're going to have a large draw from the capital region, which again, we probably won't get a recoup back on that cost. So can you explain a little bit about that to me? I'm still having a little troubles.
The question, and it's a good question in terms of accessibility. The Y's pride themselves in not, they don't want to turn anybody away. They have a policy where if you can't afford it, they will make it work. It's interesting that it was pointed out to me a few years ago. I don't know if the numbers are still the same, but I would have thought they were the opposite. But the facility that had the higher rate of folks who were needing financial assistance versus non-financial assistance was higher in the South Wyatt and in St. Vitel than it was in the one on Kimberley in East Kelowna. And it was interesting. So it's, it really speaks to council the fact that they just will not turn anybody away. So rec facility, they're open, and they feel that anybody of any financial strata are welcome. And in terms of the question about taking away, I is BRT taking away money from regional roads? We make these choices all the time, and the reality is we're going to have to do it sooner or later in terms of building rec facilities. Until somebody comes forward with an alternative strategy that will not cause us to have to add permanently tens of millions of dollars to our operating line and our operating budget to maintain these facilities and run them, I'm bringing this forward now.
Thank you.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you for bringing this forward and your leadership on this file, and Councillor Swindell and yours going forward. I mean, the whole idea of having these regional hubs makes so much sense. The reality is, though, because they're regional, people come from a greater area than the smaller facilities of the past because they're driving. But anyways, just to be very clear about that. That said, there is still, I think, a place for these smaller facilities and the existing network that's out there. It's good to hear that you're not talking about competing, putting one Y versus civic facilities. My question, though, is about the Kimberley Y. It's been upgraded and retrofitted over the years and still well used, and in a community that is, despite what you just said, perhaps in a, somewhat of a higher needs area. With the new East Station, or the new East Y, the second one that you're proposing, adopted by council, would that have any effects on the Kimberley Y?
As of now, council really hasn't adopted, unfortunately, anything specifically. It's been a kind of a policy piece, but it's not really been adopted as this is what we're doing. And I can't speak to what the Y's strategic plans are. They're a separate entity. They're a separate board of directors, and they govern themselves and their facilities. But in terms of growth, in terms of capital region, there's no doubt there's growth happening. But I would prefer residents coming into our city and doing business here than having to go out into the capital region to get a rec facility, which I think would be a total game changer for many residents. Would it be? But
constituents on Steinbeck because they have a fancy wave pool.
Absolutely, yeah. I have constituents in the West End going to Portage La Prairie because of their outdoor aquatics park, right? And
Yeah, it's, you know, the days of walking to your community club, it's changed. Even now, you know, folks drive or ride their bikes to their soccer game or drive to the hockey game. It's just, it's a different time, right?
Okay. Not hearing any other questions. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Have a great day.
Thank you. You too.
Is Councilor Gervais?
Yes, she's here. Welcome.
This delegation is Councilor Gervais. He's the Herb with respect to the Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee 2015 first quarter report, and also to be heard with respect to the operational review of the Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee.
Welcome.
Good morning. It was a bit of a rough night last night. Bit of a historically rough night last night. No, in a good way. Rough. Not enough sleep, that's all. No, it was pretty exciting in Alberta, so. for some of us. No. It's, and that's always a hard act to follow, but I'll try to turn your attention to the issue of housing in our city. And I just wanted to speak briefly to a couple of reports that are in front of you. The first one is just our regular quarterly report. Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee provides every quarterly to you. Just wanted to mention one thing that wasn't included on here was the CHRA conference that Winnipeg was on the host committee and your worship spoke at and was a very successful conference on. It was actually a congress on homelessness, housing and homelessness in Canada, a national congress here. So that wasn't mentioned in this report, but there was work done by our staff, and it was a very successful conference. But the main focus of what I wanted to talk to you about was the operational review, which is about the mandate of the committee, and I thought it was important to come and speak to you about it. I know some of the newer councillors may not be as familiar with our history on this file and the city's involvement in housing and what we're doing. And really this was, I'll just go a bit into the history of how we ended up here today. And in 2000, council basically created a housing policy, which we didn't even have really, created a pretty robust policy on, and the focus of that policy was on dealing with primarily revitalization in the inner city and primarily home ownership focus. And that was where we created the housing improvement zones that still exist today. And it was a really innovative policy at the time in the city, like it's still doing, focusing on its role in housing, but working in partnership with the other three levels of government, the other two levels of government, and with the community housing stakeholders extensively. Knowing that we can't do it alone and we just have one part of the role, but it's not totally a city responsibility, but also recognizing that if we have clear policies, let's do whatever we can do on this important issue, as we've done with things like the municipal Aboriginal strategy as well. So what is the city's role in this? So that's kind of what where it started. But then in 2011, council moved past a mandate review. Oh, and at the time in 2000, the Housing Steering Committee was created to oversee that policy and the housing improvement zones and the things we were working on housing. So in 2011, City Council altered the mandate and updated it, and it asked for an operational review. One of the things that approved was an operational review 2 years following the new housing policy once it was done. And the committee was asked to oversee creating and updating our housing policy. And so when I became chair a few years ago, that's what we started doing. And it's been really good. I'm really proud of the work that we've done. And I also want to acknowledge Winston Yee. He's in the audience. He's done an incredible work on part of the department, as well as Dave Dessens, and under the planning department. The leadership there has been fantastic. And one of the things I'm particularly proud of is that we've worked really closely with the community. There's a strong community of community economic development, housing stakeholders in Winnipeg that really care about this. And these are nonprofit, neighborhood-based organizations or nonprofit organizations that put their heart and soul into trying to find a way to move us forward in having more affordable housing. And these people have been part of this process. We've worked really hard to engage them all along. it talks about in the report, you know, we've made sure our agendas are published really early. We've had email networks to invite everyone to everything. We've had extensive consultation on all the work we've done. And as a result, when our housing policy was brought forward to the committee, when it was finally ready, we had a room full of community people in support of our housing policy, and we had no opposition to it from the community. So I think that speaks to a way of doing things that it was a really good model, and we're really proud of it. When the new housing, first we came back with a housing policy framework, which was adopted by council, and then a housing policy implementation plan, which was also adopted under the previous council. But back to the operational review. So there was a number of points that were supposed to be reviewed, and they're all in this report. We went through all of them. So the policy being developed was one of them, and that was very successful. Some of the things that have come out of the policy, it was to focus on affordable housing, but what was different about the old policy was that it also had a bigger focus on rental, which we know is an issue in the city. Now, at the time, in 2000, we were only really focusing on home ownership. The three areas that we really wanted to make sure we covered, a feeling that this was really crucial for our city, were affordable housing, but not only in the inner city, affordable housing across the city. We're looking at still continuing our emphasis on neighborhood revitalization. It continues to be very important in certain areas of the city more than others, but in those areas, a lot of areas. And thirdly, homelessness and housing. And again, I want to thank the mayor for his leadership and council for supporting the United Way's effort on homelessness. We're moving forward on that very quickly, shortly after the election. The committee's been continuing to oversee the work based on the policy, and there's been a number of things that have come forward to do with affordable housing. And again, I'd emphasize the mandate defined the city's role as focusing on affordable housing, and there's a definition of that that's included in here, that we're not talking about subsidized housing directly from the city. Although what we can do and what we would like to do is partner with the province. So if there's a project, the city's role in it might be tax increment financing to support, you know, a transit-oriented thing or a downtown thing or getting rid of surface parking or whatever policy goals we have, and then the province might stack on their programs that support subsidized housing, which is really needed. And I would also emphasize it's needed coming from the federal government and a national housing strategy. But that's another lobbying effort that's ongoing. The homelessness partnering strategy is something that our housing department, with the support of the committee and council, has signed on for a 5-year agreement. So we are the community entity that delivers federal funding of $25 million over 5 years. And that goes directly to things like Housing First programs, community organizations that are supporting the homeless initiative and housing for homeless people, and so on. So that has been a really good role, and that's helped our capacity too, because we get staffing with that from the federal government, and it doesn't cost us anything. You like that, Mr. Finance Chair, over there, smiling. The Downtown Residential Grant Program has been brought forward by this council, which is under the policy, a really great program. And again, I emphasize the innovation. You should see people's eyes light up when I describe what Winnipeg's doing with tax increment financing, looking at what are our policy goals as a city, saying you get more tax increment financing benefit by eliminating surface parking and including structured parking, by having a percentage of affordable housing. Things that are building in the downtown area, all of the things that we're trying to achieve are encouraged by the program. It's designed to do that. So they're really cutting-edge programs, and I'm really proud of them, and I think we're going to be seeing another one coming forward that's really exciting that you'll be proud of, and I hope the council will support. There's other things we're continuing to work with the neighborhood improvement zones areas and working with them closely. Rooming houses, I'm currently co-chairing a rooming house task force with Rob Altemeyer asked me to be involved in that. We're continuing to report on that through the Housing Steering Committee, and I wanted everyone to be aware of it. We're just basically trying to tackle a very difficult issue. We're losing the housing stock, and if we had a bunch of subsidized, you know, other kinds of housing available or places for people to go, it would be really nice. But we have people who are going to have nowhere to go if all of these rooming houses disappear. And we're focusing on the licensed ones. We're looking at how we can support the good landlords, perhaps, to do things. But there's challenges with that. Because there's not a lot financially, there's a lot of challenges, and some of the financial tools that we'd hoped might work may not work for that. So we're trying to find solutions of how to support that. We're working on that right now. I know Councillor Luke's also has issues with rooming houses of to do with student housing. So all of that is being worked on, and we're working on it with the province and the city together at the table, as well as community organizations and people that are involved in the neighborhoods as well, and landlords. They're all on that group, so it's kind of interesting. We're also involved, the staff is involved in the visitability task force, and visible housing is something that we're trying to include in all new developments. It doesn't actually cost very much. It actually can cost nothing. It's just a matter of designing things so that you can stay there throughout your lifespan, or if you have a disability, or if you have a kid in a stroller, or if, you know, or if you break a leg. So it just makes sense as a way of building construction. So that's some of the things we're doing on housing. So the operational review, it's in the report, and what the administration is recommending, that they believe that there's continues to be a value in having the Housing Steering Committee continue. It's made up of a number of councillors, and just to oversee and support and kind of keep the momentum going on the housing work that we're doing based on the policy, that it has value. And according to the department, they're pretty keen on us continuing to be there to support the work that they're doing to implement our policy. So I think that's pretty much what I wanted to mention. I know Councillor Morantz had asked me about the city's involvement in housing, and we do have the Winnipeg Housing Rehab Corporation that does have a small amount of housing that it still manages. So we do have a small amount of involvement in social housing and in managing some of it, but not very much anymore, and that's not our primary role. I mean, the key thing is the federal government got out of funding social housing starting in the 70s and 80s, and since then we're just not seeing it across Canada. And I also just thought I'd mention that this is a huge issue nationally, because every place in Canada, large communities, small communities, they don't have affordable housing, they don't have subsidized housing for people who need it. And this is one of the top priorities for FCM, as you know, Mr. Mayor, on the Big City Mayor's Caucus. I know they've been talking a lot about this, and we're really pushing for something from the federal government on this, and we will be continuing to do so in the election coming up from an FCM point of view, because it's not just Winnipeg, it's everybody that's in the same boat. And FCM has some really good policies that we're pushing for on the national level on this as well. So it's been, I thank you for appointing me this year to chair this, to continue to chair this group. It's been really good work I think we've been doing. So I just wanted to make you aware of it, and if anyone ever has any questions, currently Councillor Gilroy's on the committee, and Councillor Mays, and it's great to have new people on the committee too. Councillor Pachtigam was on it for many years. It's thanking him for that, and it's great to have Cindy there as well. She's really keen, and so I just thought I'd give you an update.
I really appreciate it, and it's really encouraging to see the work that's going on. You're right, the Big City Mayors Summit and ongoing efforts are to focus on really three issues leading into the federal election: infrastructure, public transit, and housing. And so it's a key issue that is a challenge and an opportunity for a growing city like Winnipeg that we share with other big cities. You know, we're in consultation, as you know, with the big city mayors in cities like Calgary and Edmonton and Toronto and Vancouver. And this committee and report is definitely moving us forward. So really appreciate your efforts on this, and just open up for questions or comments. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Have a great day.
Thank you. Your Worship, we did receive a request from two other individuals to appear in delegation. Unfortunately, that request was received past 4:30 of last night. So if the committee wishes to hear them, we would need to suspend the rules. And that would be Angela Howie and Jeff Archambault on report number 3. and that is regarding the budget amendment of Valley Gardens Community Club's spray pad project. If there's a motion to suspend.
Motion to suspend. Suspend. Okay.
Thank you.
Unanimous? All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Welcome. Morning.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor and councillors, for going to leave me up here.
Yeah, you're going solo.
I want to thank everyone for considering this motion. We're a new board at Valley Gardens, a very progressive board, and we didn't want to put a $600,000 splash pad on a facility that is in dire needs of repairs. The fields are in really bad shape, the diamonds are in bad shape, the rinks are in really bad shape. The facility inside is 40 years old next year, and so we need to maintain what we have first before building onto it. We also want to take some of this money and use the master business plan. We're hoping to eventually take over the management of the Terry Sawchuk Arena from the city and take that off the hands of the city and have it a volunteer board managing it. It was spoke about this about 10 years ago. The council at the time didn't, the councillor at the time didn't support it of Elmwood, and but the city administration was very supportive of it at the time. So with Councillor Wyatt's help with this, it sounds like administration is on board still. So, but we don't want to move ahead without anything, without a business plan, and we want to make sure that we're still viable for the community. The community is growing, and it's changing. It's changed a lot over the last 4 years, a lot of immigrants moving in. So maybe a dual hockey rink is not needed in the area anymore. Maybe a bocce ball court or, you know, something else is needed. So we want to make sure we're doing the right thing before we spend money on the facility.
Councilor Ellicott.
So I don't want to misunderstand you. You do want the $450,000 for the spray pad.
That's something, if the city still wants to move ahead with the splash pad, we'd be, if they want to move it over to the administration is talking about maybe moving over to the Elmwood EK pool area instead, we'd be totally okay with that. But there's $300,000 earmarked for Valley Gardens specifically from the development agreement. So we would like to take $150,000 of that for our use.
For the plan.
For the plan and for the field maintenance and to bring things back up.
And for the field maintenance, yes. Yeah. Well, as I checked the questions, that's a pretty expensive plan. I do suggest you talk to the Corden Community Center about they've done this. They can give you some help on the, how they've done it, including arenas and neat sets and stuff. I'd be more than happy anytime to call them. So you're looking at $150,000 right now for getting the fields up to snuff a bit. And getting the master plan of the area. So that $450,000, you're telling me right now that you're not really ready for it.
No. Okay. And it's too late this year anyway to put a splash pad in. So
just on budgeting, we're just trying to figure out the budgeting part because I don't want money to go missing for you for in the later. So that's what I'm trying to figure out. But at this point, you still envision maybe a spray pad or some other amenity that's going to cost?
If that's what the business plan says, that it's Valley Gardens is the best place for it, we'd be more than happy to have it. If the business plan says, you know what, maybe eventually in 10 to 15 years, we're going to move over to Terry Sawchuk, take over the management and build a new field house there.
Over there.
Okay. So why put the splash pad over at Valley Gardens and, you know, when we can put it over at the EK pool now, and that's closer to the Terry Sawchuk Arena.
Very wise. Okay, thank you.
Councilor Lewis.
And this is great. This is a new board, brand new board. Then it's a volunteer board.
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay.
I've been involved with a board before in the past, and we just got back on this last summer, and we've got a whole bunch of new people from the community that wanted to help out, and it's very, very exciting, and everyone's got a really good vision on it.
I've done a lot of work prior to becoming elected with community centers and boards and projects exactly like this, pulling money together, doing plans and studying it. I'm wondering if you'd be open to a bit of an amendment to the motion here. we have a lot of expert staff and insight and valuable knowledge that could be offered to you in this process. And I'm wondering maybe if we could add an amendment, something to the effect that the public service works with you and helps you and approves like the design, maybe the consultants and the contractors and specs for the site improvement, that they, you know, work and help you, guide you along with this?
Yeah, for sure. We've been working with John Kernan and Shauna already.
Excellent. Okay. And that this $150,000 be put into a sort of a grant, that we grant that to you, and then we can authorize you to go forward with it. That maybe another amendment be that the city enter into a grant agreement with you and the CFO work with the terms and conditions.
Sure.
Get the exact wording here. In accordance with other terms and conditions necessary.
Yeah, we want to work with you guys.
Yeah, and then that just sort of gives us oversight to it. Yep. And helps you, moves you along. And, is that okay?
That's perfectly acceptable. Like, we've seen, like, just taking over the management of the club, we've seen a lot of things that were mismanaged in the past.
Yeah.
So we've had to go in and clean up a lot of things, so it's great to have the city involved as much as possible.
Yeah, we've experienced that in the South End, Center. So if it's okay, I agree with the clerk on the wording of it, but that's the essence of it, that we have this expertise and guidance that we can offer you and
for sure,
and work together on it.
Perfect.
Okay.
Having some oversight, I think, on the part of the city, just to help make sure that those lines of communication are there, and I think is a really good idea. Thanks very much for the volunteer work and time you're putting into the community through this effort, and please extend our appreciation to everybody on your board for their efforts. We really do appreciate it. This is how we get things done in Winnipeg, is largely through volunteerism. So,
thank you.
Yeah. Any other comments? No. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Have a great day. Thanks for coming in.
We have no further delegations registered, Your Worship.
Okay, let's move to reports then. We'll move, first report is Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee.
Number three.
Why don't we move to that when we get to that item?
Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry. But let's let's go to report one, Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee 2015 first quarter report.
So move, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Questions, comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you. Report 2, Operational Review of the Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee.
So move, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Questions, comments? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Carried. Item 3, Budget Amendment, Valley Gardens Community Club.
Thank you, Your Worship. This is kind of an odd one. This Valley Gardens Community Club is actually straddling three civic wards, all of East Kildonan, Transcona, and
Community. Oh, really?
Committee.
Okay.
I've got the smallest part by far. It's a little tiny little corner of North Kildonan, but a lot more in East Kildonan, Elmwood, and even a piece in Transcona. So it's great to see that we have a new board that's really re-energized stuff that's going on there. The whole facility is getting kind of tired. I think what's being proposed here is good, and I understand there's a friendly amendment coming forward from Councillor Lukes, just tightening up some of the language so that there is proper oversight and transparency on everything. Nothing strange, and good to hear Jeff there, obviously fully on board with that. So I'll let Councillor Lukes, perhaps, do you have a formal
I've got her language? To help me tweak it here now.
All right, so there's a language here.
Why don't we, Councillor Lukes?
Well, I'd be more happy to hear that.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Okay, so that the public service approve the design, consultant, contractors, and specifications for all site improvements. That the city enter into a grant agreement with the Valley Gardens Community Center, and that the CFO be authorized to approve the terms and conditions of the grant agreement in accordance with the foregoing, and such other terms and conditions deemed necessary by the city solicitor, director of legal services to protect the interest of the cities. Good wording. And that subject to these recommendations, that the city provide a grant in the amount of $150,000 to the Valley Gardens Community Center for master planning and community center improvements. Basically, it's oversight.
So, if I may, Mr. Mayor, the funding of the grant will come from the developer's contribution.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. It's no new money. It's just taking that amount and putting it through a grant process so that then we can have that enables us to have the oversight and offer them that support and guidance.
Okay.
Did you want to specify that $150,000 come from the development or not?
I would.
It's I'm not sure if we need to specify that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions, comments? Okay, that amendment, do you have it in writing for the clerk?
Yes, she's.
You do? Okay,
tomorrow.
Great. Okay.
Just put the technicalities behind it.
Subject
you.
To the amendment, not hearing any other questions, comments, call question, all in favor?
Aye.
Carried, thank you. Okay, report four, zoning agreement amendment, 188 Isabel Street.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, this is a housekeeping matter. There was a construction of its importance at this location in the Centennial neighborhood to replace an old grocery store. This is just Tim Hortons wanting to repeal the zoning agreement amendment that used to apply to the old building. And just a positive word for Tim Hortons in the neighborhood. The Centennial neighborhood is really glad that it's there. Often a lot of the residents brag that there's a Tim Hortons in the neighborhood now. This is Winnipeg's poorest neighborhood, Mr. Mayor, and the Tim Hortons has really served as a community hub, so we welcome that and be happy to move number four.
It's good to hear. Questions, comments?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. We'll move to report five, rezoning 1427 Magnus Avenue.
Yeah, I'll be happy with that, Mr. Mayor. This is a rezoning. There was no opposition to this matter.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Thank you. Report six, City of Winnipeg Museums Board.
So moved.
Aye for comment.
Okay, Councillor Mays.
We talked a few minutes ago about the good work volunteers do, and this is a good example. We've got a number of very capable people on the museum's board and really an excellent staff person. I used to be the council responsible, now it's Councillor Berwati. These folks are doing some good work, coming forward with suggestions. The one suggestion they always make, though, is can you not fill the board to its capacity? We need a seventh person. I don't think Jenna from the mayor's office is here, but I'm hoping we can move that forward within the next month or so. A couple of people from St. Vital have come forward and expressed an interest, and I'd be happy to put either of them forward, but maybe there's somebody better in hard to imagine somebody better than some of the St. Vital people, but maybe there's somebody better than the mayor's office.
Keep your mind.
That the mayor's office would prefer. It's not so much a specific person, but I do think we should get this board up to capacity because they've been running a person or two short for quite a while.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, carried. Report seven. This is the YMCA, YWCA.
I'd like to move this report, please.
Actually, I think I will. This is one where I'll move and suspend the rules. So I'll move it. I think this one was moved by me.
Did you want to move the chair?
Procedurally,
can we have
sure. Councilor Lutz?
Absolutely.
Okay, so Councilor Lutz
moves. Do you need to suspend the rules?
Nope.
No.
You can move it.
Do I need to move it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're going to be recommending to council for concurrence with the motion.
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Carried. Okay. Reports eight, amendments to the tax sale penalty bylaw 8157 2002 and the accommodation tax bylaw.
Mr. Mayor, I will remove this report.
Okay. Questions, comments?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Report 9, amendment to the advertising signs business tax bylaw.
And Mr. Mayor, I will remove this report as well.
Any questions, comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Thank you. Report 10, single source negotiations, flood damage repairs to the Assiniboine Riverwalk.
I'll move the support, Mr. Mayor.
Mm-hmm. Questions, comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried.
I'll leave my consent and adjournment.
I concur. All right.
Okay, actually, if you just hold on one moment.
It's like school.
I know, sorry.
The bell rang though.
I know it's a sunny day out. We're good? Okay.
We're good?
Okay, thank you, Councillor Pat Ken. We're all in favor of adjournment.
Aye.
Aye.
Carry. Have a great day. Thanks, everyone.
Okay.
Okay. Good.